Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's great to see you here on this beautiful Sunday morning. We are so happy to have you with us in worship today. Let us begin with some announcements for each other. Do you have announcements to share with us, first of all? We have one.
I'd like for all of us today to pray for the people of Ukraine. Pray for all the people in Europe, because they are also in danger. And shame on those supporting Russia and Putin.
Thank you. Other announcements that you have this morning? If you didn't notice, there's a lot of food out in the fellowship hall, and right after worship today, we'll have lunch. So the soup has been graciously provided by Team A, and we thank them for that. I didn't have anything to do with the sign. Thank you for asking. Out in front. So in the fellowship hall right after worship, come and join us. If you didn't bring any food, please come and join us anyway, because we have a lot. Also, this week, Lent services begin. Ash Wednesday is in 3 days, and we will have worship here at 7 p.m., so please come and join us for that. If you're not able to join us for worship in the evening, I will be out in the carport area from 12 to 12:30 doing ashes on your lunch break. If you're close enough, you can drive through and get ashes there. Otherwise, come to worship at 7 p.m. The other thing I just want to note is that for those of you who pop into the office, sometimes I have a funeral tomorrow morning, and so I will not be in the office as usual, just so you're aware, and if you're planning on popping in and seeing me, I won't be there. Now, are there any other announcements that you thought of?
Pastor?
Yeah.
If anyone is interested or wanted to know, there is a celebration of life service for Becky Kirsten next Saturday at 2 o'clock at the Burmeister Hagedorn Funeral Home in Harlan.
Next Saturday, a celebration of life for Becky Kirsten in Harlan. And what was the time, did you say?
2 o'clock.
2 o'clock. Thank you for that. If there's nothing else, let's take a deep breath and focus on God's presence in this place as we begin the call to worship.
Good morning. Please rise and join me in the call to worship. The word of God came to Jonah.
The word of God comes to us.
Go.
Despite your fears,
speak
the truth of God.
Love
your neighbor and your enemy.
Forgive
as you have been forgiven.
Receive
grace upon grace overflowing from the fullness of God.
Please join in the hymn number 560, Help Us Accept Each Other.
Thank you.
join in the prayer of confession.
Holy God, we would rather proclaim death to our enemies than see them forgiven and redeemed. Forgive our hardness of heart and our reluctance to see your divine image in those who hate and despise us. Teach us to love our enemies, that our lives may proclaim your truth, that love is stronger than hate, and mercy is greater than vengeance. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated, and I'm going to invite the kids to come up for the children's message. How are you guys this morning?
Good.
We have been talking about a guy. Do you remember his name?
No.
His name's Jonah. And do you remember what happened to Jonah?
He got swallowed by a fish.
He got swallowed by a big fish. And then what happened? Did he live in there forever? No. He got spit out on the beach, didn't he? And then what did he do? Did he go home after that? Very good. He went to Nineveh, and what did he tell the people? Do you remember what he told them? To repent, right? To stop doing what they were doing and be good, right? Did the people stop? They did, didn't they? They stopped, and they asked God for forgiveness, and did God forgive them?
Yes.
He sure did. Well, today we're going to finish that story, and for a little bit of fun, I asked a couple people to help me act this story out so that you can see what happens at the end. Because God, the people asked for forgiveness, and God forgave them, and that should be the end of the story, but it's not. So at the end of the story, after the people are forgiven, and they all, you remember, they were really sorry, and they changed their ways, so Jonah, he is done with his job, and so he just leaves. And you know what he does? You're all the city of Nineveh, and Jonah walks away, and then he sits down, and you know what he does? He hopes that God is still going to punish you and ruin the city. Isn't that awful? So Jonah sits there, and he makes a little house for himself because it is very, very, very hot. Can you think? I know it's hard because it's been winter, but can you remember like the hottest day of the summer? Kind of. It's hotter than that. It's way hot. He is sweating. So he makes this little hut for himself, and God sees him, and he's like, Jonah, what are you doing? And you know what Jonah's doing? He's pouting because nothing, I know you haven't done it before, but can you pout for us? Good. Look at that face. You guys should see that. So he is pouting, and he's like, oh, why isn't God doing anything to these people yet? So what God does, can you hold that for me for a second? Actually, you take this. God asks Jonah, Jonah, is your anger a good thing? You know what Jonah says? Yeah, it is. So God gives Jonah this bush. Because it's shading Jonah, and it's making him feel so good. So now he has all this shade, and he's very happy, but he's still sitting there waiting for God to punish you. So the next day in the morning, Jonah has this bush. He's so happy. He wakes up, and he's like, today's the day. You guys are going to get punished for being bad. But God puts a worm in the tree, and you know what happens to the tree? It dies. So it's gone forever. And Jonah gets very angry about the bush dying. Right, show him how angry you are. Oh, he's so angry. He's so angry, and he's mad, and he feels bad that the tree died. And God says, is your anger a good thing?
Is your anger a good thing?
And Jonah says, yeah, it is. Totally is. And God said, Jonah, you are sad about a bush dying, but you're not sad that a whole city would be destroyed? What is wrong with that? Can you see what's wrong with that? Because that's where the story ends. There's no more in the story, so we don't know what Jonah says after that. But what do you think Jonah should say? Yeah, we should feel bad for the city, right? Not just for a tree. So what God was trying to teach Jonah is that every single person, say it with me, every single person, even the people we don't like, are welcome in God's family. That's so good. It's hard because sometimes there's people that are really mean to us, right? And if they showed up at church, it might be hard to see them here because they're so mean to us during the week, and then they're in church. That would kind of not feel the best. But God said every single person is welcome in God's family. And God wants us to have compassion and try to forgive the people even when they're bad for us. Jonah, you did a great job. Let's give Jonah and God some praise, huh? I'm going to take that. All right. So you can sit down, honey. Who's welcome in God's family? Everybody? Everybody?
Yeah.
Everybody?
Yeah.
Okay, let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your love for us.
Thank you for your love for us.
And we ask you to remind us. That that love is for everybody. Not just us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks, guys. We are going to listen to the choir now.
We'll be singing On Eagle's Wings, and Caroline Harvey Kinney will be a soloist for us today.
Any of you that have had children or been around children before, have you ever seen them throw a tantrum before? Just once or twice, maybe? Thanks to the age that we live in now, parents like to share these on the internet. And we can laugh because they're not our kids and it's not happening to us. So I pulled a couple of my favorites for you. This one says she's crying because I would not let her eat Lysol wipes for dinner. And this one is, he doesn't want to go, even though we've told him repeatedly we're not going anywhere. This says, I would not let him crawl into a 400-degree oven. So the poor kid's crying. Someone ate all the muffins? It was him. He wanted me to reattach the nails I clipped off of his feet. And then I got to pull this one from my personal archives. I ruined his life when I used the wrong color of cup. So some of these might be relatable to you because kids do throw tantrums. Adults would never get so bent out of shape about something so silly, right? Today we are going to see Jonah's story come to a close. We have seen Jonah go through many things, and today, there's no way around it, Jonah is going to throw a fit. He's having a temper tantrum, and if we were going to make a meme about Jonah, it would say that Jonah is pouting and throwing a fit because God did what God said that God was going to do. And as fun as it is to joke about this, and see these temper tantrums, I want you to ask yourself and examine just a little bit the people in your life who you are struggling to still forgive. And is it possible that when we pray for forgiveness to happen, when we pray for a relationship to be healed, when we have prayed for retaliation to be kept at bay, and then we actually see those things start to happen, we don't like it. And we can even get angry about it. I know that we are all dealing with different levels of forgiveness in here. Some of us are trying to forgive people who have said things to us that have hurt us, and some of us are trying to forgive people who have caused a lot of harm and a lot of agony in our lives. All of us are on different levels and situations of forgiveness, but there is one thing that is the same in all of these situations. Inviting God into the process of forgiveness will definitely create change and will move you forward in some capacity. When we ask God to come into the situation, God will. And God will do things. And then we can get angry about that. For instance, you may start to ask and pray for forgiveness for someone. Maybe it's someone that you run into frequently. And you might run into that person and find yourself, your first reaction, smiling at them instead of scowling like normal. And you might catch yourself smiling at them, and then you remember, wait, I'm angry. And then when you realize that you weren't angry when you saw that person, you can get angry that you weren't angry when you saw that person. There are times when we will pray for ourselves to be released of anger and resentment, and then we can get mad when we realize that God has come through and helped us do just that. And that's exactly where we find Jonah today. You already know from our previous weeks that Jonah has ran from God because he did not want to participate in God's message of forgiveness. He spent a few days in the belly of a big fish thinking about it. He comes to the realization that whatever God wants to do should be God's plan, right? It's not my decision to make. He goes and declares to Nineveh his very short message, and the people repent, and God saves the city. That's what was at the end of chapter 3. So now here we are in the beginning of chapter 4 today. If you have your Bibles, then I would invite you to pull those out and join me there. In the end of chapter 3, God saw what they were doing, that they had ceased their behavior, changed their ways, and he stopped the plan to destroy them. In verse 1, Jonah thought that this was utterly wrong, and he became angry. He said to God, "Come on, God. Wasn't this exactly why I ran away from you in the first place? This is why I fled. I know that you're merciful. I know you're compassionate. I know you're patient. I know you're very full of love, and I know you're willing not to destroy. At this point, Lord, you may as well take my life from me, because it would be better for me to die than to live." Jonah is very dramatic, isn't he? He is having the worst kind of tantrum here. The Lord responded, I want you to say this with me, "Is your anger a good thing?" Jonah goes out from the city and he sits and watches. He made a hut and sat under it in the shade to see what would happen. Recognize that Jonah is so angry with God for following through with what God said God was going to do. And he clearly states that his tantrum is because God is compassionate and loving and full of grace and didn't want to destroy anybody. And even though Jonah went in and preached repentance and the people changed their behavior, Jonah still fully expects to go out and watch the city be destroyed. And now God is going to try to teach Jonah a lesson through a tree. The Lord provided a shrub, and it grew over Jonah, providing shade for his head and saving him from his misery. Jonah was very happy about the shrub, and God provided the next day a worm, and it attacked the shrub so that it died. The sun rose, and God provided a dry east wind, and the sun beat down on Jonah's head so hard that he became faint. He begged he might die. He said, it's better for me to die than to live. And God said to Jonah, say it with me, is your anger about the shrub a good thing? And Jonah says, yes. Yes, it is, God, even to the point of death. And this is what reminded me about the pictures of the kids throwing the tantrums when we laughed. What they are crying about is so silly to us. It's ridiculous, right? And here's Jonah, sitting on his hill, having his tantrum, and he's telling God he would rather die than to see the people that he despises saved. He would rather die than live to see his enemies forgiven. And the Lord says to Jonah, Jonah, you pitied a tree. You didn't plant it. You didn't water it. You didn't care for it. You didn't do anything to make it grow. And you pitied it. And it perished. It came and it perished in a night. And yet you cannot understand why I would have pity for a city of more than 120,000 people who I created, who I made in my image, who I have watched grow, who I love. And that's it. There is no more to the story. I wish the story went on so we could see what happens and what Jonah's response is, but we don't really need to. We have all that we need to know right here. Jonah is angry, and we might think, rightfully so, the people that Jonah is angry with were horrible, awful people. They plundered and murdered Jonah's people. They caused him great harm and his people great harm and agony. But God had accepted these people and desired for them to repent and come in to the family of God. But Jonah doesn't believe that they deserve forgiveness, even if God does. And I think that might be the most relatable part of this whole story for some of us. Why would God offer grace to people who have hurt us so deeply? God's love is so extensive. It is hard to wrap my mind around, and I don't know if it is for you. But it is a love that would care for 120,000 people in a whole city, and it is a love that would care for just one angry heart. It is a love that would not want to see anything that God created put to death and perish. And it's also a love that would want one single faithful heart to not remain trapped in anger. God repeatedly asks Jonah, is your anger a good thing? Because we are so good at fooling ourselves that our anger stays pointed right at that one person that we're angry with. But friends, it does not. Anger is something that seeps into all areas of our lives, in all of our relationships, in all of our conversations, in all of our actions, whether we are conscious of it or not. Is your anger a good thing? The reason God returned to Jonah to speak with him individually was because God wanted Jonah to be on board with what God was doing. He returns to tell Jonah and to remind him that God loves Jonah just as much as he loves the entire city. And this is not a punishment to Jonah to see his enemies given grace. It's a gift. God doesn't want your heart or anyone else's to be enslaved to anger or resentment, because like a worm, it is deadly. God loves you so much that God wants to heal your heart. And as we see in the story today, this is a process. Forgiveness is rarely ever a one and done. It's something we have to continue to do over and over and over again, even with the same person. But God loves you so much that God desires for your heart to be free from all of that hurt. So as you go through this process, maybe for the rest of your life, be open to that love. be humble enough to realize that it's not just for us, it's for everybody else, even the people that we don't like. But God loves you so much that he wants to free you from stubbornness, from anger, from hurt. So don't stay stubborn like Jonah. Let us allow God to heal us and to let his love soak in. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we pray that you might release us from anger, from resentment, from bitterness, and from holding grudges. Knowing that that does not make whatever happened okay, but just knowing that you desire for us to be free from those feelings. Knowing also that this is something we will have to work on and ask for your help over and over again. Grant us your strength and your grace in the process. But may we be willing participants in healing love in this world. God, we lift up to you this morning all who are heavy on our hearts. We especially take a moment to pray for the people of Ukraine and those who are torn by war right now. God, we pray for those who are grieving this morning. We pray for those who are in need of your healing touch. We lift up to you the people who we are still struggling to forgive and invite you into the process. We pray for the people who need to forgive us. God, we pray that you might keep unlimited forgiveness on our hearts and on our lips, leaving us free to speak and to act and to love more like your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. I'm going to invite you into praising God through your tithes and offerings this morning. And if you need assistance, the ushers will be around to help you. Friends, please join me in the prayer of thanksgiving. God of mercy, you provide all that we need. As first you give your provisions to us, so now we bring our gifts to you. May they reflect the love and concern we have for our neighbors. May they represent our commitment to build communities of freedom and hope. Amen. Amen. I'm going to invite you to remain standing as we sing hymn number 368, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less. Telling you something about lunch, bless you, and then we'll all go eat, okay?
Okay, when we get out here, we're going to have a pleasant contest again. Looks like Team A stepped up to the plate good today. We got 11 different soups, okay?
Right.
Yeah, and they look good. The desserts, Team B, yeah, average. But there's little cups and there's bowls. So if you want to try several different soups, just grab a cup. And then when you're done and time to vote, over on the little table, there's paper you can vote for. Okay? There's two bowls. And then when we're all done, Mary will announce the winner and present the trophies. So enjoy.
Thank you. All right. Let's bless you and your food all together. Because of your worship here today, may have you been blessed. May have you been reminded of God's love for you, and might that propel you to go out and share God's love with other people. Bless the food that we are about to eat and the hands that have prepared it, that it might strengthen us to go out and be the disciples that God has called us to be. Amen?
Amen. Amen.